affect the flow. Fashions change. Something like 150, 200 years ago, well, they looked like this. Nowadays, they look more like this. You know, the woman inside the clothes is still very much like she was 200 years ago. But the clothes that she's wrapped up in are very different. And that's how it is often with science too. If we look at this rock face, for example, about 150, 200 years ago, almost all the geologists looking at that would say, well, here we've got obviously rocks laid down by very rapid deposition in water. It's obvious, this is all laid down very quickly in water. Now, almost all geologists would look at this and say, this is laid down little by little over millions of years. The rock face is still pretty much the same as it was 200 years ago, but the story surrounding it is completely different. What happened to change the story? Well, very largely, the story was changed because of a book, Principles of Geology, written by Charles Lyell. Now, we've looked at Charles Lyell a little last week. This book, Principles of Geology, had a huge influence on many things, especially on geology. In that book, he said, no causes whatever have, from the earliest time to which we can look back to the present, ever acted, but those now acting. And they have never acted with different degrees of energy from which they now exert. Now this, Lyell called the uniformity principle, or the principle of uniformitarianism. And that is the basis on which the whole geological story was built. This geological story comes in three parts. This part is a sequence of fossils. And then we have rocks which are named by the fossils that they contain, or at least that's the story. And then over next to the rocks, we have ages laid down for them. Now, where do these ages come from? Well, the idea was to find the thickest layer of rocks anywhere in the world which had this kind of fossils and were therefore Cambrian. And then you look for the thickest layer in the world of this kind of rock, this kind of fossil-containing rock. It will be somewhere else, of course. But then we can find the thickest we can find anywhere in the world, and we say, right, that's the thickness of the Ordovician. So we go all the way up, looking for the place in the world with the biggest stack of rocks containing those fossils, and then we pile them all on top of each other and say, that's how thick the geological column is. Then we say, we look at the oceans today, and sediment is being deposited at about 1/8 of an inch a century. That's about 3 millimeters a century. And by the uniformity principle, it's always been like that as far back as history goes. Therefore, this huge stack of rocks we've got must have accumulated at 3 millimeters a century. So that means it must be 600 million years in total. Now, there is nowhere in the world where you find a stack of rocks that thick. There are very few places where you find rocks which are in this order. And even when you do, they don't have this sequence of fossils. There's nowhere in the world that you find this sequence of crystals. And you usually find these mixed up with some from up here, underneath, some from down there, and the order doesn't work out. It is a purely theoretical construct, and that theoretical construct and the uniformity principle is the reason for 600 million years. Nothing to do with radiometric dating. None of this is dated by radiometric dating. All of it was dated by the uniformity principle, saying this stack of rocks is that thick, therefore it must represent so many hundreds of millions of years. Now, it is a story about fossils. And the story goes something like this. Creatures die and they fall to the ground or fall to the bottom of the sea. And then most of them get destroyed by scavengers and things like that. But some, say one in a million, doesn't get destroyed and it gets covered up. Well, if only one in a million gets preserved, and this is 100 million years, then we'll get 100 times the population preserved. That's a vast number. So if anything is alive in this period, we'll have fossils of it. But there's a problem. Scientists have built platforms on the bottom of the sea to observe fossils forming. They've built platforms on the bottom of lakes. They've set up study all over the place. And they haven't been able to see any fossils forming like this. When a creature dies, it just gets chewed up by the scavengers. The bones all drift apart and even they crumble and disappear. Nothing gets preserved. There are very few places where there are conditions which can allow fossilization. It's very rare. And yet, when we look in the rocks, we find many places, this is from Agate Springs in America, where there are hundreds, thousands of millions of fossils. They've all been fossilized together. And it's not just one place. There are plenty of these fossil graveyards. And although nothing seems to be fossilizing now, there was a time in the past when fossils were formed by their millions. And there are other things wrong with this story. For example, we can see this at Saint Etienne in France. We have got tree trunks. These are about 10 meters long. They're big. And they're standing upright in horizontal layers of sediment. Now, according to the story, this sediment was laid down 3 millimeters a century. But while this was standing in its first 3 millimeters, why didn't it fall over? And while these were in their first few millimeters of sediment, why didn't the woodworm and things come and eat this up over the thousands of years that it took for that to get covered? Wood doesn't last for thousands of years and stays well preserved at the top and the bottom. This obviously was not done slowly over thousands of years. This happened so quickly that these things didn't even have time to fall over. And then we find fossils like this. Now it's quite obvious this fish didn't die and fall to the bottom of the sea. It's busy gobbling up its dinner, which is another fish. And you can see there's muscular activity going on here as it thrusts itself forward to gobble that fish up. And suddenly, it was suddenly encased in so much sediment that it didn't even have time to relax its muscles. Fish protein decays very quickly. But every scale, everything is perfectly in place. This was not only engulfed in sediment quickly, it fossilized very quickly. And then we have another problem. I want to illustrate that problem with a piece of sandstone that came from a quarry outside a town called London in Texas. And the sandstone quarry is dated as Ordovician. If you remember that geological column, it's right down at the bottom, just above the Cambrian, 500 million years ago. And the reason that the quarry is dated that age is because it has pelecypod fossils, which are index fossils for the Ordovician. But there's a problem for that, because this piece of sandstone, which came from that quarry, has got some wood sticking out. It's actually partially coalified spruce. Now the problem with that is spruce isn't supposed to have evolved until the Triassic, which is hundreds of millions of years later. Well, they got over that problem by reclassifying this rock as Triassic. They knocked off about 300 million years with the stroke of a pen. I wish I was a geologist. I'd be happy to knock off a few years, not just, well, just a few years off my age with the stroke of a pen. But anyway, if you're a geologist, you can knock millions of years off. But that didn't actually solve the problem. Because when this rock was broken open, you could see that this piece of spruce is part of the handle of an iron hammer. And the only creature which is supposed to have been able to make iron hammers with spruce handles isn't supposed to have come along until right at the very top of that geological column. So we find in one piece of stone, evidence from down here, right in the middle, and right at the top. What does this tell us? Those things are not a time sequence. There isn't a time sequence. They all happened at once. Well, that shouldn't surprise us. It shouldn't surprise anybody to find that there are major problems with the geological story, because almost all scientists these days are convinced the Earth has been hit by at least one major meteorite. Now, this one that we're going to look at, it was first put forward, the evidence for it was put forward by two geologists, Alvarez and Alvarez. It's a father and son team. And their evidence for this meteorite was so convincing that people said, well, yes, the Earth has been hit by a major meteorite, but there's a problem. The uniformity principle doesn't allow for it. It says nothing has happened in the past except what's happening here and now. And we're not being hit by major meteorites here and now. So this is going to play havoc with the uniformity principle. So they kept this meteorite as small as they could and still fitting with the evidence. They came up with a size of 10 kilometers in diameter. Now that's a pretty impressive meteorite. And a group of scientists at Caltech, which is one of the most prestigious science universities in the world, led by Thomas J. Ahrens and Dubin O'Keefe, did a lot of calculations on this meteorite. And they showed that a 10-kilometer meteorite would throw up hundreds of thousands of millions of tons of water, which would, of course, rapidly come down very quickly doing a great deal of erosion and deposition, it would have evaporated hundreds of thousands of millions of tons of water, which would soon have condensed and come down as rain, doing more erosion. It would have raised a tidal wave, which nowadays they call tsunamis, 5 kilometers high, which would have been moving at the speed of sound. Now, here we've got an artist's impression of a much smaller tidal wave, but this is going to wash away this whole city. Now, NASA's artist did an attempt at a 5 kilometer high tidal wave. Now, this gives you some idea of the height. It's towering way above those clouds. But it gives you no idea of the power of a wall of water 5 kilometers high moving at the speed of sound. That is not only going to wash mountains away, it's going to wash mountain ranges away very, very quickly. And it's also going to instantly wash away the uniformity principle. Now, although Alvarez and Alvarez in the 1980s were the first people to make the idea of a meteorite impact popular, it was first put forward by an Australian astronomer called George Dodwell. And he put forward this idea about 100 years ago. But nobody would listen to him. Now, he put forward his ideas because of his work on the changing tilt of the Earth's axis. And he found observations of the Earth's axis tilt going right back to about 2000 BC. If we look in detail at the top end there, we can see that there were measurements taken by some pretty prestigious people. We've got Copernicus, we've got Ibn Yunis, we've got Ptolemy, Hipparchus, Eratosthenes, Pythias, Thales, some very well recognized thinkers here, and they all fit very well on this curve. But there's a problem with that curve, because they're not supposed to fit on that curve. They're supposed to fit on this curve given by Newcomb's formula. Now, the reason they're supposed to fit on this curve is that the scientists have worked out that the changing tilt of the Earth's axis is due to the gravitational attraction of the Sun, the Moon, and the planets on the Earth's equatorial bulge. The Earth is fatter at the equator, greater than it is at the poles, and the Sun, Moon, and planets working on the Earth are supposed to make the Earth follow Newcomb's curve. And so they're all convinced it must follow Newcomb's curve, because the equations say it must follow Newcomb's curve. So when Dodwell showed them that they all fit on another curve, they said, oh, well, the observations must be inaccurate. Well, Dodwell looked into it to see how these observations have been taken and how accurate are they. Well, in principle, they were all taken with a very simple apparatus called a gnomon. Now, in principle, a gnomon is just a vertical pole on a level surface. In practice, they are a good deal more sophisticated than that, but in principle, that's all it is. And with your gnomon, you wait until midday at the winter solstice, when the sun is as low in the sky as it goes, and you measure the length of the shadow that's cast. And then you wait for the summer solstice, when the sun is as high as it ever gets in the sky, and the shadow is the shortest, and at midday you measure the length of the shadow. Now, if you call the foot of the gnomon A, the point where the summer solstice shadow is B, and the point where the winter solstice shadow comes C, and if Y is halfway between B and C, then the Earth axis tilt, or twice the Earth's axis tilt, is the angle BXC. But Dodwell noted also that AXY is the latitude of the observing station. So he has a check on the accuracy of those observations. Because it's recorded where the observations were made, all he had to do was see how accurately they predicted the latitude, and he could see how accurate their measurements were. And they were all very accurate. He built a gnomon, and he found he was easily able to get a minute of accuracy. Now, 1 minute of accuracy will fix your position on the Earth to within 1 mile. So that curve is well within the accuracy of the gnomon, and it shows that Newcomb's curve is not a full story. Now, he was convinced that these people did their work accurately. He looked at the people who'd done it. Manilius, for example, was a Roman mathematician, and his gnomon was the great obelisk in Rome. And on the top of that obelisk, he put a device for casting a very sharp shadow, and he laid his scales are made of brass. He laid them into the plaza around the obelisk so that there would be no inaccuracy due to moving the scales. And he was so convinced of the accuracy of his measurements that he was prepared to abandon his idea that the universe is fixed and unchanging. He said, "These observations now for 30 years are not consistent. There has been some change in the universal Earth by which it has moved away from its center, as I have detected myself, and hereof also from other places." So these people were so confident of the accuracy of their observations, they were prepared to abandon their preconceived ideas about nothing changing. Dodwell was really convinced that this is the right curve because all the observations fit on it, and he was convinced that something had happened at about 2500 BC, 4,500 years ago. And that is just about the time when Noah's flood occurred. So he said, "Well, look, this is important. Is there any other evidence which shows this is right?" And he found lots of evidence. Most of the great temples that were built in the past have been orientated towards the sun. Now, Stonehenge is a very famous one. This is orientated to the rising of the sun, and everything is organized so that when you look down it, the sun rises and the light shines through these things onto the altar and the sacrifices offered. The archaeologists looking at this, studying it, came to the conclusion it was built between 300 and 400 BC by the Druids. But not so very long ago, it became very popular among astronomers to look at temples like Stonehenge. And Fred Hoyle was one of them, and he looked at Stonehenge, and as all the astronomers did, came to the conclusion that Stonehenge must have been built about 2000 BC. The archaeologists said there's no chance. There is no chance it's that old. It's between 300 and 400 BC. The astronomer said, "No chance, it's older than that." And that problem of the disagreement between the astronomers and the archaeologists was even more pronounced with the biggest temple that's ever been built. This is the great temple of Amun-Ra at Karnak in Egypt. Very large, as you can see, it's in ruins, but there is enough there to reconstruct it. And the archaeologists have reconstructed it. And the first part of it that was built was the inner sanctuary. Now, the inner sanctuary was used once a year at sunset on the summer solstice, when the sun moved as far north as it ever went on the western horizon. As it reached the horizon, its light shone in through an avenue of ram-head sphinxes, through a series of pylons, and then into the entrance, onto the altar, and onto the golden idol behind it. And as the setting sun shone in, Pharaoh walked in, bathed in sunlight, like the sun god himself incarnate, and the sacrifice was offered on the altar. Well, the rest of this was built by succeeding pharaohs, but it was always used for the same thing. And the last part of this was built by Ramses III in about 1570 BC. But the problem with this is, the astronomers say it can't happen. But we know it does happen because everything is written on the pillars. You can see here an archaeologist, and he has covered this pillar with plastic, and he is tracing all the hieroglyphics, and then he'll take it back to his university and study it. This has been going on for quite a while. And here at the outer edges, all this is written on the pillars. You can see we're looking out towards the horizon. There's this avenue of ram's head sphinxes, and the sun shines down here, and then through several pylons behind us, onto the altar. And we know it happened because it's written on the pillars. But as far as the astronomers go, it can't have happened because Newcomb's curve doesn't go far enough ever to allow the sun to come in. But if we look at Dodwell's curve, the sun gets in at exactly the right date, 1570 BC. Again, we see Dodwell's curve agrees with the evidence. Newcomb's doesn't. And we can also see why the astronomers say Stonehenge must have been about 2000 BC, because if you look at Newcomb's curve, the sun gets to the right alignment to about 1900 BC. But on Dodwell's curve, it gets in 400 BC. Just what the archaeologists had said. So once again, Dodwell's curve is supported. It's obviously the right thing. Now, he calculated that this curve could occur if the Earth had been hit by a meteorite 200 kilometers in diameter. Well, a few years ago, I landed at Jan Smuts Airport. As I came into the terminal building, I saw this photograph on a newspaper, Pretoria News. And I thought, that's interesting, so I went over and got a copy, and it said, NASA scientists now believe that the meteorite that hit the Earth was 200 kilometers in diameter. I thought, aha, exactly as Dodwell said. And now if you look at the later meteorite, shown by NASA's artist, you can see this is very much bigger. Now, if a 10 kilometer diameter meteorite would cause a tidal wave 5 kilometers high sweeping around the Earth at the speed of sound, what is this going to do? They calculated that the 10-kilometer meteorite would make earthquakes millions of times more powerful than anything we know about. This is going to make earthquakes tens of millions of times more powerful than anything we know about. Ahrens and O'Keefe, in their original paper, where they put forward all their calculations, they said from the transient cavity, a tidal wave about 3 miles high, that's 5 kilometers high, would envelop the entire Earth in 27 hours. Remember, this is from a 10-kilometer meteorite. I haven't heard of people calculating for a 200-kilometer, but it's going to be a whole lot bigger than this. And when they presented their paper, they asked a question. They said, how would it be possible for anything to survive? Everything would be drowned. Now, we never hear that question asked. What we hear about is this meteorite throwing up lots of dust into the atmosphere. And the dust cuts out the sunlight so that the plants don't grow and there's not enough food for the dinosaurs and they die of starvation. But they pointed out they wouldn't have time to die of starvation. They'd all be drowned. We never hear about that. I wonder, why not? Is it because it sounds just too much like what the Bible says? Like in Amos 9, for example. It talks of he that calleth for the waters of the sea and poureth them out upon the face of the earth. The Lord is his name. And the vast majority of secular humanist scientists want to hear nothing at all about the war. So we hear about dust, dinosaurs dying of starvation because the plants didn't grow. We never hear about them, obviously, all getting drowned. Well, if we look at this rock face we looked at before, you will see that there are a lot of people here. These are geologists. And you'll see they're all looking at one particular place. They're looking at a layer of rock 1 centimeter thick. And that centimeter layer goes all the way around the Earth. And these people will tell you that that 1 centimeter layer is the total evidence left of that meteorite. Now, when you look at this, it is all very convincing for sediment laid down in water. I have personally experienced a flood in Lesotho, and when the water level went down, there were meters of stuff that looked just like this, exactly like this. In the laboratory, you can create this very easily just by precipitating stuff through water. Now, if we've got waves 5 kilometers high rushing around the Earth at the speed of sound, surely it's going to do more than just 1 centimeter. Surely it would be much more reasonable to think that this whole lot was laid down by that water. And they'll say, oh no, obviously that's not possible, because in the rock record, we've got evidence that that can't be the case. We have between the layers of rock places where it's obvious that there is wind-blown sand. There are heaps of wind-blown sand. How could sand be dry and blown by the wind in a flood? Other places, we've got layers where clay has dried out to the extent that it's cracked. Well, how could the clay dry out and crack if the whole Earth is suffering a flood? And then there are other places where there are scratches in the rock and there are unsorted tilts, that's heaps of gravel and sand and stone all together. And so, well, the only thing that ever produces striations, that's scratches in rocks and unsorted tilts, it's glaciers. And they move at a few centimeters a year. And to make these scratches, that represents lots of time. So how could that happen if the whole Earth is suffering a one-year flood? So clearly, this represents much more time and not a flood. Well, what can we say to that? The problem is nobody has ever witnessed what happens when tidal waves 5 kilometers high rush around the entire Earth in 27 hours. But we do have some experience of much smaller events. For example, this is a report from an American warship. Disbelief repeatedly gripped a Lieutenant Billings. I witnessed the terror the afternoon of August 13, 1864, from the side-wheeler USS Bentwater Ree, anchored in the harbour of Arica, Peru, now part of Chile. He helplessly watched a nightmare unfold as an earthquake leveled the town. An hour later, the first wave of a tsunami slithered under his vessel and engulfed frantic survivors clustered on the wharf. Then the waters receded until the harbour floor lay exposed, leaving other ships lying on their beam ends. But the flat-bottomed watery remained upright. Well, they were fortunate. Being a flat-bottomed side-wheeler, they remained relatively undamaged. But the other ships were on their beam ends. And a point to notice, if water goes up somewhere, it has to go down somewhere else. Now, water can go up as high as you like, but if it gets down to the bottom, it can't go any lower, and the bottom is left exposed. This went way out to the horizon. Well, let's look at what happens in the rest of the story. The sun had set when the Watery's lookout spotted the next wave. We made out a thin phosphorescent line rising higher and higher. Below it loomed frightful masses of black water, nearly 15 meters, 50 feet tall. The wave swallowed the Watery for a suffocating eternity before it depositing her 3 kilometers inland. Now, the first thing to notice about 15 meter high waves is that they are very powerful, very destructive, terrifying, and as absolutely nothing compared to a 5 kilometer high wave. Now, another scientist who looked at the question of meteorite impacts, and again, he's only looking at the 10 kilometer one. Nobody seems to want to do calculations on the 200 kilometer one. But he said this: even if it hit the ocean, the impact would have created a crater 300 kilometers across. A huge plume would have pushed the atmosphere aside. The fireball would have had a radius of several thousand kilometers. Winds of hundreds of kilometers an hour would have swept the planet for hours. Well, that's interesting. If we've got the seabed left exposed, this enormous wave has rushed on, and now we're left with the seabed exposed. If we've got winds with fireball temperatures at hundreds of kilometers an hour, waiting for 27 hours before the water comes back, isn't there time that some sand could have dried out and been blown into heaps? Isn't it possible that some clay could have been dried out to the point where it cracked? And what about the story of striations unsorted tilts? Well, it's true that glaciers, which move very slowly, can drag along rocks which fall down the cracks, and they make scratches called striations. And when they melt, they dump all the stuff that they're carrying, whether it's sand, pebbles, stones, all at once. But it's been found that when you have earthquakes, mud flows occur, and mud flows can also drag rocks along and scratch the rock. They also dump unsalted tills, but they travel at about 100 kilometers an hour. Now, the calculations show earthquakes millions of times more powerful than any of those we know about. Surely they would produce mud flows, which would produce striations and unsalted tills. So those that we see in the geological record need have nothing to do with ice moving at centimeters a year. They could just as well have been formed by mud flows moving at 100 kilometers an hour. Well, there's one other thing that the geologists put forward when you put all this to them and say, look, your time scale falls apart. They say, yes, but look at the Grand Canyon. It's been eroded out by the Colorado River, and we know how much is being eroded every year. It would take, I think it's 19 million years to erode out all this material, so we're looking at a very long time. But there's a question. Was this eroded out by the Colorado River running as it does today? Of course, Lyell's uniformity principle says it must, because nothing happened in the past other than what we see happening now. But is that uniformity principle true? There is a canyon here which has a river flowing at the bottom. It's called the North Fork of the Tuttle River. And if this canyon had been eroded out by the Tuttle River, it would have taken a very long time. But actually, it was observed that this formed in one day. It was in May 1980 when Mount St. Helens erupted. There was an earthquake, only 5.3 or 5.6 on the Richter scale, many millions of times less powerful than the one that the meteorite would have created. That earthquake produced a mud flow which cut out this whole canyon, and it goes on for a long way in one day. The Tuttle River flows in the bottom because it's a drainage feature and the rain concentrates there. But that river did not carve out the canyon. The canyon was carved out by something else very quickly. Well, there's evidence that the Grand Canyon also was carved out very quickly, because in the upstream part, we have got what are called incised meanders. The river meanders around, and here we've got an enormous thickness of rock, a kilometer or more. The problem with that is, if you do experiments, you find that water flowing around a meander stops cutting down as soon as it reaches any rock that is hard, and instead cuts across and just wipes out the whole meander. So if any layers here had been hard when this river was cutting down, it would not have caused this meander, it would have just cut across. That means this whole lot were soft. To be soft, they had just been deposited. This lot was all deposited very quickly. It was all soft, and then runoff water cut this out very quickly. And just look at this rock face. You can see here finely banded layers, just like a normal rock face. And the geologists will tell you This takes thousands, billions of years. This was also laid down as a result of the Mount St. Helens eruption. It was laid down in one day. Now, if that much is laid down in one day from a very small, comparatively, event, surely it's much more reasonable to think that this lot, which is obviously all laid down in water continuously, this whole lot was also laid down very quickly. And there's one final piece of evidence that I want to show you that agrees with that. I don't know how many of you have been to see the Hubble meteorite. Now, this picture makes it look bigger than it really is. I used a very wide angle lens because I wanted to show this shiny bit here. You see that? A souvenir hunter tried to chip off a bit, and so he's broken through the blackened surface as this thing came through the Earth's atmosphere. It burned from the heat. But underneath, it is stainless steel. At the moment, about 300 meteorites are observed to land on the Earth every year. All the scientists are convinced that in the past, there were more. Because in the past, there was more space debris. Very much has been collected, it's been swept into the sun, a lot onto the Earth, a lot onto the planets. There's much less now than there used to be. But even so, still 300 meteorites arriving on the Earth every year. Now, if it were true that this part of the geological core were actually 600 million years old, then even if there were only 300 per year in the past, you would have about 200,000 million meteorites in this section of the geological column, and not one has ever been found. There should have been more than 100 just in the coal mined in the last century. But in all the mining of every mineral, in all the excavations, in all the geological explorations, all the engineering works done, not one single meteorite, all the way from the Cambrian to the recent. Now, down at the pre-Cambrian-Cambrian boundary, it's the only place in the whole geological record which looks like an old landform. Everywhere else, it doesn't. It's deposition on deposition. And down here, at this apparent old landform, there are meteorites found there. And there are meteorites found right up at the top where we are now. But all the way from there to the present, not one meteorite. This lot was obviously laid down so quickly there was not time for a lot of meteorites to fall in it. This was all laid down very quickly. Well, with so much evidence available to anybody, and just looking at surfaces like this, and you can see that was laid down in water continuously, one could wonder, why are these geologists all putting their attention on 1 centimeter and saying, that's the sum total? Why do they not open their eyes, stand back and look and say, well, look, this is all laid down very quickly in the flood. Why don't they open their eyes and see it? Well, the Bible tells us in 2 Peter chapter 3, there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts and saying, Where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. Does this sound familiar? All things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. That's the uniformity principle. That's what these scoffers will be saying, it says, and that's exactly what they are saying. They are willingly ignorant. All the evidence is there, anybody can see it, but they don't want to know. They are being willfully ignorant. Why don't they want to open their eyes and see the evidence? Well, the answer is actually quite simple. It's because the flood is described in the Bible, and it is a judgment from God on sin. And the Bible also tells of another judgment that is coming. And that's something that a secular humanist, someone who would rather live in sin than in godliness, doesn't want to hear about. In fact, it's something which should terrify every single one of us. But fortunately, the Bible also tells us how it's going to be possible to stand on that day of judgment. There is a way, and that is to have an advocate to plead our cause. And that advocate is the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is the only help we are going to have on that judgment. I don't know how many of you have made a commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. But when that judgment comes, that is going to be your salvation. And we don't know when that's coming. So if you have not committed your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, it would be a good idea to do it very quickly, because there may not be a tomorrow.
In Stonehenge, how do you think they got the rocks on top? Because they have a lot of theories about that as well. From, I don't know what, to aliens, you know. Some people say it was aliens and they used these spaceships, and that's the only technology or people that would be able to do that. What do you think, how did it happen? Or?
Well, it's very clear that there was a great deal of advanced technology that got lost. If you look at all the early civilizations, they all talk of a golden age, an age when man had enormous knowledge, ability, technology, which has been lost. If one looks at the evidence from what things were like pre-flood, I believe it's pretty convincing that there was a very high-tech civilization. There is evidence that they could fly. There is some evidence that they could launch spacecraft. There is some evidence that they had a nuclear war. The whole evolution story is that people were originally very primitive and they could only make stone axes and things. And there's been a steady progress towards us. Just look what we can do today. We can do anything. But the real history suggests that there was a very high-tech civilization which got destroyed, and there's a memory of it. And some things people were able to do, but even that knowledge got lost. And the obvious place where it all got lost is in the flood. And the enormously high-tech civilizations which the ancients look back to as the Golden Age is the pre-flood era. Now, moving enormous blocks of stone, the ones at Stonehenge are as nothing compared to the ones at Tiahuanaco. And there are other places in South America too where there are blocks, hundreds of tons, which have been accurately shaped and then moved into position in buildings. And it's only in the last century that we have had machinery which can move blocks that big. In fact, there is one block. It's a place called Sacsayhuaman. It is so huge, there is no way it can be moved today. It's enormous, and it has been transported from the quarry where it was quarried to where it now stands, over a mountain. There's a mountain in between. And nobody has a clue how it could be done. I suspect it was done by using transport based on the Earth's magnetic field. Now, the magnetic field has faded away since then to the point where it's hardly usable. It's now just about usable for pointing a compass needle north, and the bees can still use it for navigation, but it's no longer powerful enough to use for transportation. But I think in those days it certainly was. It was extremely powerful. So how they did it, we don't know. We can be certain they had a very high technology. I suspect it was a technology based on electricity and magnetism.
Before the flood of Noah, what was the population of the Earth at that stage for the flood?
We can only estimate. Yeah. And the estimates that I have come across range from about 2,000 million to 100,000 million. Now, the idea of there being more people then than there are now is not that far-fetched, because it's almost certain that before the flood there was more land than sea. It was all very well watered and fertile. It could carry a far greater population of all creatures than the Earth now. A large part of the Earth today is desert. And it appears that before the flood there wasn't any desert. And the Bible certainly indicates that before the flood the whole Earth was well watered and fertile. So it's certainly feasible that there was a bigger population than we have now. And when one considers the length of time that people lived, the length of time that they were reproductively potent was enormous compared. Nowadays it's something like, 20 years. Whereas then, with something like 600 or 700 years, being potent, one could produce an awful lot of children.
Do you think the people were literally like 900 years old? Or
yes.
Could it be possible that they maybe calculated their months differently? Maybe at shorter months, for example?
Oh, no. The conditions pre-flood were, by anyone's calculation, vastly better suited to life than conditions now. Now the Earth is being bombarded by high energy radiation, which does a great deal of genetic damage. There are investigations that have been going on which suggest that there is so much genetic damage going on because of radiation that about 300 mutations are getting fixed with every reproduction. That is a catastrophic figure. It leads to what the geneticists call error catastrophe in the genome, because you can only have so much deterioration before the genome is not feasible, it can't reproduce. So we are subject to a great deal of rapid decay. Pre-flood, with a magnetic field many times stronger than we have, that forms a shield sweeping all the harmful radiation out of the way. It's so weak now that most of it gets through. The atmosphere was probably much more dense. A meteorite striking the Earth would have probably got rid of about half the atmosphere. So we probably have half the atmospheric pressure now. Now that fits in with observations of plants, because they work much more efficiently at double the atmospheric pressure. It looks as if they were designed to work at about twice the pressure we now have. Now, the transpiration rate is much quicker than they need. It leads to drying out, and they suffer from the consequences. They get rid of more water than they need, and then they're left needing water. Whereas it's much more efficient at twice the pressure. So there's a number of lines of observation which suggest that before the disaster, there was twice the atmospheric pressure, with twice the oxygen intake with every breath. You're getting much better oxygenation of the bloodstream. Everything would work better. Now, if one has some very serious problems, like serious burns, it's been found that if you were put in what they call a hyperbaric chamber with twice the atmospheric pressure, then you recover very much better. Everything seems to go on better. The children born under higher pressure seem to be far more intelligent. They learn languages so quickly that they just pulls apart from most normal kids. So it would appear that in the conditions pre-flood, we would have a much more healthy population, a much cleverer population, and one which would survive better in every way. So an age of 900 would not be at all unfeasible.
Philip, there was a question asked during the break that it seemed like a lot of the slides dealt with a meteorite. And how does that exactly fit in with what the Bible teaches about the flood, being the earth being ripped up and the rain and so forth?
Well, the Bible is not very specific on exactly what happens. It says, in that day, all the fountains of the great deep were broken up. Now, it doesn't say why they broke up. there could have somehow been some pressure building up in the earth and just burst. It could have been a meteorite that would have broken up all the fountains of the Great Deep. It would have broken up a great deal. But we don't know. We're not told what caused the fountains of the Great Deep to be broken up. And it's the fountains of the Great Deep being broken up, which is the first thing. It then talks about the rain. It then talks about the windows of heaven being opened and the rain pouring down. Not the rain first. Now, I suspect that this rain pouring down would be exactly what one would expect from a meteorite impact. These secular scientists predicted exactly that. They predicted hundreds of thousands of millions of tons of the water thrown up coming down as rain, and hundreds of thousands of millions of tons of the water that was evaporated condensing and coming down as rain. So that also fits very well with the idea of a meteorite impact. Whether that was the case, we will only know when we come to the one who can answer all our questions, because nobody knows now. The only information we have is what's in the Bible, and it's a very brief account. There are lots of questions that I'd like to ask that are not covered. But as Paul says, one day I will know as I am known. Now we see through a glass darkly. And I'm eager to ask exactly what happened.
I'd like to ask if meteorites do really exist, and if they do, could you please somehow let us know how do they really form in the atmosphere? How do they form? How do the rocks form?
Nobody knows. They were presumably created when everything else was created. And presumably, all the other things, the planets, the meteorites, asteroids, were also created. Because until recently, all such bodies have been called stars. It's only recently that they've decided that stars are great balls of gas which have nuclear reactions in them. Now, whether they actually do have nuclear reactions, whether they are great balls of gas, is another question. But that's what they're now defined as. So that things like planets, meteorites, are no longer defined. They're no longer defined as stars. But that's a recent definition, and they could very well come under "He made the stars also."
Based on the meteorites, while we are talking, I was wondering if we mentioned 300 meteorites hitting the Earth every year. Why would they be so small now, apart from being gobbled up by the sun? But is there another reason why it would have been a big one way back then? And then also, you mentioned about the meteorites in the different layers of Cambrian and rock and so forth. There's no meteorites being found there. Are they being found now? Every year when we see 300, are there some of them lying on the ground and so forth, that we can know that they actually should, if we can see them now forming on the ground, they should obviously have been in one of the rock layers?
Yes, well, I'm not sure where this figure of 300 a year comes from, but I'm actually quite confident it's an underestimate. There are some places where meteorites are easier to find than others. The easiest place is in the desert. So there was an American organization that wanted some meteorite specimens, so they offered people in the Sahara Desert a fair amount of money for each meteorite they brought in. They were astounded at how many they found. They're readily available. Now, really big ones are much rarer than smaller ones. The frequency that you get depends on the size. The big ones are scarce. 10 times smaller, they're 10 times more frequent. 10 times smaller, they're 10 times more frequent. The vast majority of the meteoric material which strikes the Earth is fine dust. And that burns out in the atmosphere, or it slows down. If it's small enough, it just slows down and then drifts down as dust. A little bigger than that, where it can penetrate far enough to be heated up, then that burns out. You can see it as shooting stars. And it isn't until you get to a fairly reasonable size before it is big enough to get through the atmosphere, strike the Earth, and then it's called a meteorite. It's only called a meteorite if it strikes the Earth. All those that burn up beforehand, they're meteors. And the smaller they are, the more numerous they are. So each size bigger, you find less. So when it comes to the really big ones, they are rare, very rare. In my lifetime, I've known of two fairly serious scares when they've located meteorites close enough for there to be a chance that it would hit the Earth, and they only detected it a few days before it would have hit. And one of them they only detected after it had passed. Now it had missed the Earth by a few thousand kilometers, but on astronomical terms that's not very much, and they hadn't even seen it until it went past. So there is a definite chance that the Earth could be hit by another one. It's very difficult to spot them coming, and we would have very little notice. At one stage, there were plans to launch rockets equipped with nuclear warheads to try and either break it up or deflect it. But it turned out it wasn't needed, because it missed the Earth by a few thousand kilometers. But it was such a serious possibility that they were seriously looking into sending nuclear weapons to try and deflect it, or at least break it up so the pieces hitting the Earth might not be so big.
But I suppose there won't be one big enough to destroy the Earth.
Well, no, because the Bible tells us the next judgment will be by fire.
Yeah.
If there were another meteorite that hit the Earth, it would also guarantee tidal waves as big as this. And the Bible says that God will not destroy the Earth again by a flood. So we will not be hit by a meteorite that big. We might be hit by one considerably smaller, which would do a great deal of damage, but not big enough to create waves which would sweep around the entire Earth and drown everything. Yes.
So I'd like to know, how does a meteorite differ from the asteroid? What's the difference between the two?
A meteorite is one that strikes the Earth. Now, if you had an asteroid, which is in an orbit around the Sun, if something disturbed that orbit so that it came to hit the Earth, it would then be a meteorite.
When you described the 5 kilometer waves, I was thinking that unless by supernatural invention, even something like the Ark would be deposited at the bottom of the ocean. So I was just thinking, is there a practical thing you can mention why the Ark stayed adrift in a catastrophe like that?
Right, I am quite convinced that the Ark could not have survived without supernatural intervention. I'm quite convinced of that. But now, what I find very interesting is if you look at the Earth's surface and you look at the crack patterns which might indicate where this meteorite hit. There in the Pacific Ocean. There you get an indication, if it hit anywhere, the crack patterns suggest this was it. Now, if you look at where the arc probably was, which is probably somewhere around Jerusalem, because Jerusalem has some very special spiritual significance. That's where everything happens. That's where there is a huge fight on between Satan and God's children. That's exactly on the opposite side of the globe to where it appears the meteorite probably hit. Now, if you hit here and the wave spreads out, going all the way around the Earth, then it arrives at the arc from every direction. So instead of the arc being squashed flat, it's hit from all directions at once and stands a chance of just going straight up. It's interesting to be just on the opposite side of the globe to where the arc would have been. But even so, I'm quite convinced that there was supernatural intervention in everything to do with the ark. How did he know he had to build it? God told him. How did he get it built? Well, there would have been so much opposition. It's amazing that he could ever have got it built. How did the animals get there? God brought them. Now, there's silly little children's story books or colouring books which show Noah and his sons going out on donkeys herding them. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says God brought them. There's supernatural intervention all the way, and he's not going to allow that to be destroyed. I'm sure he had his angels bearing it up in their hands.
I wanted to ask, when you get a meteorite rain, they call it?
A shower.
A meteorite shower, how often does that occur? And does some of those hit the Earth during meteorite normally? Or?
No, they're not meteorite showers, they're meteor showers.
Meteor showers.
They almost all burn up in the atmosphere. Any that doesn't and does come through then becomes a meteorite.
Yeah.
And meteor showers are common, and it appears that most of the well-known meteor showers are debris from comets. As comets come close to the sun, they heat up and the ice that they're formed from, not just water ice but other gases, it melts and it blows off, taking material with it. And if you remember the picture last week of Ikiyoseki, the tail was something like 10 million kilometers long and a million kilometers wide. And when the Earth goes through a former comet tail, it is going through all that material lost from the comet. Now, most of those pieces that are lost from the comet are not big. So they all burn up as meteors as they come into the atmosphere.
We believe there was an ark, but is there any evidence to prove that there was? I mean, is anybody, or scientists or archaeologists, found any evidence of the ark?
Well, that's interesting. The prime evidence we have that there was an ark is that there is still life on Earth today. And the question Aaron's asked, how could anything survive? There's only one answer that I've ever heard of. That's they survived on the boat. So I think that's the prime piece of evidence. If you don't believe what the Bible said. There have been some very interesting reports of sightings of the Ark. There have been interesting reports of visits to the Ark. There are a number of people today who have tried to get to the Ark and have been prevented by a group in the mountains of Ararat who consider it their duty to preserve it and prevent people reaching it. Now, there are some very interesting stories, like one, the Russian pilots in the First World War who flew over Ararat in a very warm summer when there was a very big meltback of ice. And they claimed they had seen the Ark in a glacier, but there was so much melt that a lot of it was visible. And they, when they got back to Russia, they reported this to the Tsar. I think they took photographs, and the Tsar organized an expedition to go there and examine it. But the revolution came before that group got there, and it never happened. There is this a fairly credible story of an American, I think he was a military doctor, and he was in the region of Ararat, and he saved the life of one of the tribesmen, and he took them to their people, and they befriended him, and they took him to see the Ark. And his description fit very well with the description of the Russian pilots. And he had not seen that description. There are stories, how accurate they are, I don't know, of satellite photographs also during warm summers with big meltback, where the satellite photos certainly suggest that the Ark is broken into two pieces. It's been broken and one part stayed frozen in the ice, and the other part slid down and is now something like 100 or 200 meters away. But it's all stories that it's very difficult to confirm. Now, I am convinced that when the time is ripe, if those remains are there, the Lord will allow them to be discovered as a sort of final, this is your last chance. If you don't believe this now and still refuse, you've no one but yourself to blame. I personally suspect it is going to be found just before the end.
Philip, just for interest's sake, do you think somebody can rebuild the Ark with the instructions that the Lord gave in the Bible? Do you think lots of the instructions wasn't mentioned in the Bible?
The instructions are very scanty. And I think if you follow those instructions, you could come up with many different looking arcs. I'm sure one could build something which had those dimensions. Whether it would look like the original, I don't know. Very much of what the Bible talks about is in such sketchy detail that I can't get a really clear picture. My clearest picture of the Ark is from reconstructions by these people who claim to have seen it. But their claims might not be true.
Based on that, I'm thinking one of the people you are referring to might be Dr. Karl Bau. I was just wondering, Dr. Karl Bau, which I'm sure you're familiar with.
I've met him, yes.
Okay. nice. they've got a nice scale of the Ark, which is, fairly like a, it's not a pretty boat with a beam, it's just a a wooden, almost like a matchbox, very long, you know, it's just not beautiful. But they actually put it on a small scale flood, you know, with water going around. And they said they tried all different sorts of shapes of boats that we find today. And all of those sank with just a little bit of beating of the water. That's the only specific format. It was just perfect to counter every wave. It just never sank. It was just very interesting.
Yes, hydrodynamically, it is an extremely good design for floating. It's not a good design for powered transport, but for staying afloat, it's an excellent design.
Well, you spoke about the age of man back then, like Noah with Carolina and Jess. I thought it's scary because I think with time you gain wisdom. It's not a given, but I think if you are 900 years old, you must have, you know, some things by then and must be wise. And if you couldn't change your life in 900 years and live the way God wants you to, with all the wisdom, you can just imagine how wise you're supposed to be after 900 years, then it doesn't look too well for us now. Because we think we are wise and clever now, and we don't even reach 100 years.
Ah, yes. And we think we are so clever with our science and our technology. And somebody today has to study for, say, 20 years to be really an expert in the field. And then he's got maybe another 20 years to utilize that expertise. You look back to there, they had enough time to study for, say, 50 years. And then they've still got another 800 years to be an expert. You know, just think of the possibilities for advancement. It's far greater than the possibilities today. And there's not only the possibility of gaining wisdom, but if you are going to go on the line of corruption, there is the ability to develop huge skills and insights into theft and fraud and just corruption as well. So you've got the possibility of going very high or very low.
I was thinking with all this talk about meteorites, I mean, a meteorite like that would just, you don't even need the Bible for that. That will just totally refute evolution. Because if that happened 4,500 years ago, there's no time for anything to evolve after that, which I think is a pretty good argument. Is this an acceptable, is this a widely acceptable theory about the meteorite? Even among secular, you know, people that know something, not the Dawkins and the stuff, but people that are, you know, is this an acceptable wide theory that people can't refute, or?
Well, I think the idea that the Earth has been hit by a meteorite is pretty nearly irrefutable. I think just about everybody accepts it. What they do not accept is Dodwell's work. They accept, well, sometime millions and billions of years ago, the Earth got hit by a meteorite. And it wiped out lots of things. But there's been enough time afterwards for things to evolve back again. But looking at the evidence that this happened 4,500 years ago, no, they want to close their eyes. Now those measurements are there for anybody to look at. They have been a source of, shall we say, amazement to scientists for quite a long time. Dodwell actually got onto this by reading a book called Dreisonia. It was by a professor of mathematics, I think at the Royal Naval College in England. And he was trying to explain the observations which show that the Earth has followed this path, and he was trying to explain it by some kind of geophysics, but it didn't work. And when Dodwell went through his work, he checked all his sources and found, yes, all this information, all these observations are available in libraries all over the world. And he went through them, he went through the calculations, he built his own gnomon to see how accurate it could be. He used the instructions given by the people who did the early observations. He did exactly what they did, built exactly the same kind of gnomon they did, and took readings in the same way, and got the same kind of results, excellent accuracy. And he went to places like Karnak. There are lots of temples that he went to, I only mentioned two, Stonehenge and Amun-Ra, but he went to others as well. And he subjected the whole thing to close scrutiny, and he was an astronomer, a good mathematician. And he was quite convinced that all the evidence is there and it points straight to 4,500 years ago. But nobody would accept it because they didn't want to. They don't mind the Earth being hit by meteorites, but not 4,500 years ago. Now, he wrote a book, and he wanted to get it published. Now, I'm fortunate in having a copy of his book. It's not published, it's his manuscript. And those slides that I gave come from the manuscript that he wrote. Now, that the rights to that manuscript were bought by an organization in America, and they have squashed it. They have not published it, they bought the copyright, but they are just keeping it under wraps. They are not publishing it. The only way you will get Dodwell's book is if you can get a copy of those manuscripts. But nobody wants to publish it. They don't want this information public. They don't want to accept it. Because 4,500 years ago, it agrees perfectly with the Bible, but it completely wipes out evolution, it wipes out geology, it wipes out all the so-called evidence that the Bible's not true. So people hate that. They'd rather buy the copyright and squash it.